All right, you guys ready to open up God's word? I'm excited. So let me pray for us. Father God, we thank you. God, we thank you for the crazy, awesome ways that you use this little church, Lord, from, you know, faith-filled houses of sobriety to being able to bless our community with brand, not just clothes, but brand new clothes. It's pretty incredible, Lord, and sending us to other countries on other continents is just, it's crazy. So God, we just, we give you all the praise and all the glory, and we say thank you for being faithful. And we just worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to start this morning in the book of Ecclesiastes. Has anybody ever read Ecclesiastes? Has any of you ever thought it was depressing? Yeah? All right, well, not after today, all right? It is not a depressing book, and I'm gonna tell you why. We're gonna start and talk about something. It's gonna sound depressing, but just bear with me for a minute, because I think that when we open it up and we actually talk about like what is actually trying to be, or not trying, but being communicated to us, it's actually very freeing. So if you haven't read it, basically the whole book is about somebody who has tried everything that the world has to offer. How many of you guys have gone out and tried some things that the world has to offer? Yeah? And basically the conclusion that the storyteller here comes away with is that all things are futile, or they're called, or some translations say vapor, or meaningless. And so that's kind of the whole, you know, gist of the story, and that's why some people are like, very depressing. So everything I do is just meaningless. Well, we'll talk about that. But there are some things that transcend time, and they have meaning, and those are the things that are going to be found in the Lord. And we're going to talk about that too. But to get there, let's talk about this first chapter of Ecclesiastes, and let's talk about things that are either considered futile, meaningless, or vapor, and see if we can actually be blessed by this rather than depressed by this, okay? Right. Sound good?
Yep.
Okay, so it says, the words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem, meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, utterly meaningless, everything is meaningless. What do people gain from all their labors at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow to the sea, yet the sea is never full. To the place the streams come from, there they return again. All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again, and what has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations. Even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. Pretty uplifting, right? Do you say cool? Oh, you say cool? Because that was my first thing when I read this. I was like, this is awesome. I had like not, I honestly, I don't think I really had ever paid attention to this particular book of the Bible until about a year ago. And I just like, I got this new Bible and I just was like, I want to read through Ecclesiastes. And I was like, this is the most gangster book. I love this. It's just like straight up telling you like everything you don't want to hear, but probably need to hear, right? And that's why I love this book, because it's gonna really answer some questions or bring clarity to some things in our life that maybe we need clarity with. And so the first ideas, I wrote a couple ideas, and one of the ideas is the lie that's told is that each newer generation is somehow more advanced than the last. Young people look at older people like anything they might have to say is old hat. Okay, Would you agree that that's probably true? That when you even ask yourself this, if you think about people who lived 500 years ago, do you kind of think that they might have been dumber than you? Yeah, right? Like that maybe you go back like into the Dark Ages. Somebody says medieval times, and you like, medieval times, medieval mindsets. They just weren't very bright, you know? And we have this tendency to think that we're always progressing, and our generation is somehow smarter or more capable than the last. And it's just not true. We might know more things, but that doesn't make us somehow superior. We might have greater technology, but that doesn't make us any different than somebody from 2,000 years ago. Okay, somebody living at the time of Jesus was just as aware as you are of the things around them, their experience that they're having. They just didn't have the technology. They didn't have Google. So yeah, maybe there's some stuff they didn't know, but their human experience wasn't any different, right? And they thought that they would look back 1,000 years and they would think that what a bunch of dummies, right? Like they would thought that they were like ahead of the curve. And the same goes as a youth pastor. When I was a youth pastor and as somebody who used to be young, right? What I found as a youth pastor is I would tell kids, warn kids about the problems that come with partying and drugs and crime and all these things. And, you know, I was a youth pastor in my 30s, so mid-30s, so pushing towards my 40s. And they would just look at me like, yeah, whatever, right? Like, it's things have changed, okay? And it's like, no, things have not changed. Like, why won't you listen to me? And you could just tell that in their young mind, they somehow think that they're smarter than me, or they've got a better handle on it than I did, or things have changed, right? But things haven't changed. They were the same for they'll be the same for these kids as they were for me, and as they were for somebody 20 years older than me and beyond, right? The truths of the world do not change, and people as a whole really don't progress. And I love that this scripture points out, it's like, just because you're going to live this one generation, about 80 years, and so you think that you've got it figured out. But the truth is you haven't lived long enough to realize that there's nothing new actually happening. People have been doing the same thing over and over and over again for thousands of years. If vampires were real, you could sit down with a vampire and ask him if I'm right, okay? Vampire would be like, dude, yeah, it's the same thing. You guys have smartphones now, but you guys are doing the exact same thing. Trust me, I've been watching. Right? And so what happens is, you know, it's especially with the younger generation, we'll just pick on them for a minute, is oftentimes they'll reject wisdom and believe that somehow they're just smarter than the old timers, and this whole thing, you know, kind of goes on, right? And I think we see this in, you know, our culture today is there's all this progressive stuff. And hey, listen, you can only humans can only progress to that sweet spot of like becoming like Christ. That's progress. But anything beyond that is not progress. You're just going back to where you started, right? And so there's this lie that we love to believe as humans that somehow we can transcend and progress beyond ourselves and somehow create something, you know, truly better. But if we're progressing past, you know, what God says, that's not progress, right? That's not progress. We've overshot. And we actually, the way I kind of look at it is I see progress as kind of like a circle. And I'll put Jesus at the top, right? Jesus is right here at the top. So you could be down here at the bottom circle, making your way up, okay? You get to Jesus, that's good. But then you keep going, what happens? You're going back down. You're going back down, and around we go. I love that the author of Ecclesiastes understands this, right? Yeah, so people love to believe that the old ways are bad and the new ways are progress, but the truth is there is nothing new. It's all been done. If you go in, you can read a great biblical example. You could read through 1 and 2 Kings, and you can watch from king after king that one will show up and be great, amazing. And you'll be like, all right, everything's fixed. they made Israel great again or whatever, you know, and then the next king comes and he wrecks it all, and then another king comes and he makes it better, and then another king comes and wrecks it all. And it's just over and over and over and over and over again of people doing, they get back to that sweet spot with Jesus, and then they push for this progress, this progression, and they end up in a mess, and then somebody has to come and bring it back here, and you just see that this cycle happens again and again and again, and every generation probably thinks that they're cutting edge and that they're somehow, you know, pioneering a new way or doing something new, but the truth is there's nothing new under the sun. People love to chase these fantasies of in life in hopes that indulging in one's own desires, that they will somehow bring them peace. And when we talk about, you know, progress and things like this, that, you know, the world is always looking for an easy way out, for convenience. If I could just have what I want, then I will have peace. If I could just get this thing or experience that thing or live this lifestyle, somehow I'm going to satisfy the hunger within me. But no matter how much they consume, the hunger is always still there. Remember, he says that the eyes, they never see enough. The ears, they're never satisfied. They always need more. And we will try to build empires and legacies in hopes that one day we will not be forgotten. And in Ecclesiastes, he's like, one day you will be forgotten. Yeah, it can seem depressing, right? It's like, gosh, well then, what's the point? We're going to get to that in a minute. The Vanderbilts in the late 1800s and early 1900s were like, people would call this family, they're railroad tycoons, you know. The equivalent today of how much money they had made would probably be like billionaire or something like that. They were considered, this family was considered like American royalty. They were like the people. You go to the East Coast and you can check out some of their mansions. They have a mansion that is on the coast on the Atlantic Ocean, up in I think Rhode Island. Yeah, it's called the Breaker's House, and it's magnificent. And this is where they just went to hang out, like. You know, like, hey, let's get out of our bigger house and go here. And they were on top of the world, had all kinds of money. One would say, if you were the head of that household, I can't remember what his name is, the husband, you might actually believe, like, you know what, I'm probably never going to be forgotten, and I've created generational wealth, and I've created this legacy. Well, the truth is within two generations after him, all the money was squandered. The kids spent it all. You know, and even I'm telling you a story, I can't remember the guy's name. I remember his last name, and I remember enough details of the story to share it. And the reason I remember the stories is because of the fact that they acquired all this. They built this kingdom here on earth, and within two generations, it was gone. The Vanderbilts do not own their houses anymore. You can go and tour them, and there's one Vanderbilt lady who they've allowed to live up in this house, the Breaker's House, that is in the East Coast. She has an apartment in the top of this huge mansion that they've allowed her to, like, live in, but she doesn't own the house, right? And so she's still there, but not there. So even if you do a great job at building your empire and getting all the things that you think you want and trying to be remembered and trying to leave this legacy, you have no control over what's going to happen after you die. The people that are usually remembered are the people who do really terrible things, right? So people probably know more about Hitler than they do George Washington, right? So you don't want to be remembered for that, right? And my point is a question I want to ask is, does it matter? Do we need to be remembered? Do we need, you know, something new? Do we need to be satisfied by something outside of the Lord? Do we need to spend our life's energy and our life's effort trying to chase things that are vapor, that in the end, they're not going to matter. We spend a lot of time, I think, thinking about stuff that the Lord would say, like, listen, that's not even, you're stressed out about something that is temporal. You should be focused on what's eternal. You know, I have an oak tree in my yard that I planted 3 years ago, and I go out there and I look for new growth. I love summertime because I can watch my trees grow, and one day my oak tree will be about 70 feet tall. It's going to be a big tree, and it's going to take about 20 years more for it to get somewhere near this size. But the tree itself is going to live to be like 300 to 500 years old if nobody comes and cuts it down. So sometimes I'm out there and I realize when I think about that, I'm like, man, one day I'm going to die and this tree that I planted is going to be doing fine. Thriving. My children will die and the tree will be doing fine. People one day will sit under the tree and have no clue of who I am or even wonder to think about who planted this tree. They will just enjoy the shade of that tree. And by then, when that day comes, everything that I own today that I love, that I think is cool, will either be destroyed or somebody else's or in a pawn shop or who knows what. Right? All my special stuff. Even my really cool guitar that Brian Head Welsh from Korn gave me. Who knows where that's going to be? I'm going to hold on to it until my dying day. I'll tell you that right now. It'll be, I'll bless you. Just bury me with that guitar. And if I'm really lucky, maybe someone in my family, generations from now, will have a picture of me and from time to time pull it out and briefly tell who I was. But the description of who I was will probably take 2 minutes or less, right? Oh, that was your great-great-grandpa Nicholas, and yeah, he had a cool guitar, and he's buried with it now, and okay, next page. Well, that's your Aunt Sally right there, right? Listen, this is just being real. The author of Ecclesiastes is not trying to depress us. He's trying to set us free from living a life that is caught up in the things of this world that do not matter. He's not trying to depress us. He's trying to set us free. When we know that certain things are vapor, meaningless, it frees us up to do the things that have meaning. It allows us to be more effective, not less. It simplifies. He's offering us a moment of clarity. The only reason it's depressing, I think, is because we read through it and we're like, oh, I'm doing all those things, and what you're saying, they don't matter. It's like, okay, but just take a minute and understand that having clarity and realizing if something is meaningless in my life allows me to reposition it, okay? Not saying to get rid of your whatever or to go throw your money in the street or whatever unless the Lord tells you to, but just understand that if much of these things we're talking about are up here on your list of priorities, you might want to rethink that. Because from an eternal perspective, they're not gonna age well. Our time on earth is finite. So we need to free our mind from the pressures of this world that tell us that we have to be something or do something that won't last. We need to focus on what is eternal. So I think many of us allow the important things to take a back seat in order to make greater space for the things in the end that will be meaningless. You know, the other night I was with Jackson, my son, and we're sitting in his room, and every night after dinner, the house is a mess, and I put Jackson to sleep, my wife puts Bodie to sleep, and I have a ton of chores that I have to do before I can go to bed, but or to even relax, and I can't do those until I put Jackson to sleep. And so I got to brush his teeth, change his diaper, read him 3 books, all the stuff, and pray with them, I pray with them. And it's pretty amazing to watch him pray. And we every night we pray for his mom, his brother, for him, and for me a little bit. But we do all those things. And when all those things are done, then if he lays down and goes to bed, I go start doing dishes and cleaning up toys and cleaning up the other rooms and putting everything away. And then if there's any time after that, I'll sit down and I'll have maybe 40 minutes, maybe an hour to watch TV. And I spend 20 of it just trying to figure out what I want to watch, because Netflix has so many options that I can't figure out what movie to watch. By the time I'm done, I just got to watch a show, an episode. Can't even be a movie. But something ends up happening almost every time as I'm laying there with my son, and I say, okay, I got to go. And he says, no. And he climbs up on my chest and just lays on me. And he just lays there, and he keeps moving around trying to get comfortable. He's got his little guys. He's trying to use them as a pillow. And in that moment, I realized that there are things that are more important than going and doing the chores and all the dishes. That there are things that actually should come first. And if it means that I'm not going to have any time to stare at Netflix options for 20 minutes or whatever, like, I'm going to be with my son. I'm going to be there and let him love on me. Listen, we have to understand that if we're spending our life chasing things that are vapor and not making time for the things that are not vapor, we got a problem. There'll always be time to do the dishes. There'll always be time to clean up. And if I get less sleep, that's okay. Because I would rather be there with my son and let him experience my love in that moment. See, there's a lot in this world that is meaningless, but not everything in this world is meaningless. The human soul is not meaningless. I mean, you want to invest in anything, invest into people, because we're the only things on this planet that are going to go on from here. If you want your life to tell a story that's worth remembering, let it be the gospel story. Let it be God in your life, shining out of you, creating a culture within your family that will hopefully last generations, that will be more valuable to your great-great-great-grandkids than any amount of money that you could ever leave them. When my grandpa, before he passed away, my dad's dad, a guy who never told his sons that he loved them, he was a hard man, he wasn't a nice man, he was a cheater, he was a lot of really terrible things. You know, in his 80s, and he was almost, I think, 90 when he died, so late 80s, early 90s, all he wanted to talk about was what a hard worker he was. I never heard him once. He's got 4 sons. And I've never heard him once say, you know what, I'm just so proud of my boys. All it was about him and the things that he accomplished. And he's gone now. And to be honest, none of us really care that much about that part of his life. It saddens me that even at the end, he had an opportunity to shower his sons with love, and he chose to lift himself up and talk about how strong he was and how much he provided and how much he worked. There are more important things. So I say today we accept this invitation into clarity. We remove the shackles of all the stress, of all the things that the world wants to weigh us down with. And be free. I'm not saying quit your job or anything like that, so don't hear what I'm not saying. You guys all quit your job and be like, okay, well, go find a job. Because now you're broke. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying to ignore responsibilities. I'm just saying to understand their place. They're not going to carry value like other things that you could be doing, right? I love, showing my son love through the way that I treat him. But now that he's older, I'm sharing the gospel with him. And so we're going to shift gears just for a minute, and hopefully we'll have time. It's important that one of the things that we can share is the gospel message. It is one of the things that we can pass on that actually does have value, that is not vapor. In fact, it's the most important message on the planet. And so with my boy, I'm going to show him my love, but I'm also going to share with my words the truth. I'm going to share the truth with my boy so that hopefully when he goes, that when he passes, that he will go and be with the Lord too. It's the best news that there is. The greatest accomplishments of our lives in the end will be, did we lead people to Christ? I mean, that's eternal, right? In 1 Corinthians 2, verses 1 through 5, it says, "And so it was with me, brothers and sisters, when I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about our God, for I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except for Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power." See, Paul was obsessed with the gospel message. And I don't think that, sometimes I wonder if when I read through, the letters always start with the gospel, like Jesus Christ, our Lord. There's always this bringing up of the gospel, not by works, but by faith, the saving grace in Jesus. And here he is saying, like, when I come to you, it's not about being eloquent. It's not about having a bunch of cool stuff to say. I resolve to know nothing except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I love that he goes on to say that God's power confirms the message, right? That's incredible. You want to see the power of God start showing up? Start proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ. As he focused on the gospel message, he demonstrated the power of God that confirms the gospel. And what is the gospel? Romans 1:16, he says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone." Say that, everyone. "Who believes, first to the Jew and then to the Gentile." Listen, man, the world wants you to be sorry for being a Christian. The world wants you to feel bad about believing in Jesus. This is true. It's out there. But I love it. Paul says, "I'm not going to be ashamed, because of the power of the message can save lives." One of the things we need to remember is that this, not only is this the most powerful message that there is, but because you're the one going out and sharing it, it makes you the good guy. You're not the bad guy. Paul was obsessed with sharing the message that saves souls. In 2 Corinthians 4:4, it says, "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God." The God of this world, Satan, has blinded the mind of unbelievers. And they're heading off into a direction towards a freight train. Okay? Now, if you saw a blind person heading towards a freight train, would you feel bad about warning them?
No,
No. Even if they were mad at you, like, quit it. You're like, but you can't see. Well, stop telling. There's no freight train. Like, okay, but I just got to tell you. I just got to tell you. I think that we spend too much time worrying about how people are going to react to the message that has the power to save their soul. It's incredibly important for me that my boys know the gospel. My sons especially. And it's also incredibly important to me that you know the gospel. And beyond that, it has to matter to me that other people should know the gospel too. This isn't rocket surgery, right? The way to eternal life is not, it's so simple. It's so easy. Putting our trust back in God, our faith back in God, saves us. That's incredible. It's not difficult. The message itself is simple. Any one of us can share the message. Romans 10, 9 through 12, it says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's easy. Amen. Right? It's an easy message. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. That's crazy, that there is a rich blessing in the gospel message. We should want people to know this message. I think a lot of times we, instead of sharing the message, we just try to create a Christian culture. Christian culture will bring about good things, right? If people start acting in Christian ways and doing life in Christian ways, and if they hang around you and you're not sharing the gospel, but you're showing them Christian ways, they might catch on and say, oh, I want to do that too. That's better. Okay, maybe it'll lead to a conversation about the gospel. Maybe it won't. But we have to remember that Christian culture does not save people. Christ alone saves people. Christ alone. So if we're satisfied with creating Christian culture, we're not actually saving people unless we're having the conversation. Someone has to speak. Romans chapter 10, 14 through 15. How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. How many of you guys want to have pretty feet? Simple question. I know my boy Flowers does. Sean over there. His last name is Flores. That means flowers, right? Yeah. So. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. Listen. He says, how can they believe if they've not heard? How can they hear if somebody doesn't tell them? Man, whose responsibility is it starting to sound like it is? It sounds like it's my responsibility. I'm the one that knows the message. I must share the message. I was on the coast with my brother-in-law, and we were out fishing, and there was a guy who came up, and he was drinking a beer. Nice guy. Wasn't drunk or anything. And my brother-in-law, who's a Christian too, we're fishing, and I start talking to the guy just about the fish that we're catching, and that's it. My brother-in-law reels in his line. He goes over to the guy, and he goes, have you heard about Jesus Christ? And he just starts a conversation about Jesus with this guy. And I'm the pastor. I'm like, oh, I should have done that. No, I wasn't going to do that. I was taking the easy tactic that oftentimes I take is I'll just be kind and just show them Christ in my actions, which I'm not saying is a bad thing, okay? But they might just think I'm a nice guy, and that's not going to save them. Meeting Nick, the nice guy, is not going to get you into heaven, okay? Me being a nice guy is not going to get me into heaven. It's only Jesus Christ. So we have to, as we use these other ways, we have to be willing to have the conversation. And you might think, Nick, I'm not even qualified to share the gospel. If that's what you think, hold on. Look what Paul says about a bunch of swindlers who preach the gospel. So Paul gets word that there's people out there and they're preaching for personal gain and they're trying to actually create trouble. Check out what Paul says. Philippians 1, 15 through 18. He says, it is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry. Some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition. Say that, selfish ambition. Has anybody ever seen a preacher where they think that they're doing it for selfish ambition?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. They preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely. Not even sincerely are they preaching Christ, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But he says this, what does it matter? Wait, what? Well, it matters a lot. What does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, I will continue to rejoice. Wow. That is incredible. That is incredible. The message is powerful, and that power works regardless of who shares the message. It could be the worst, most swindling person in the world sharing the gospel, and the gospel message still is powerful. It has nothing to do with the guy sharing it. It is powerful because of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
So if you think that you're not qualified to share the gospel message, Paul's rejoicing when these freaking weirdos share it. How much better off would you be? Paul would rejoice today if you walk out of here and you share the message of Jesus Christ. Even if your motives are false. He doesn't even say, because of this I rejoice. He doubles down and says, I will continue to rejoice. It's good. Thank you, Paul, for being more mature than we are sometimes. But see, he's seeing through the vapor, right? He's seeing through the meaningless and just focusing on what has meaning. He's like, you guys are all caught up on that person's character, why they're doing it, their motives, and you're missing the point. They are preaching Jesus. People are being saved. It's good. Man, and not only that, the gospel is so important to Paul that he would meet people at any place in their lives and hopes to reach them. Check this out. 1 Corinthians 9, 19 through 23, he says, though I am free and belong to no one, I love this, I am free, I belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone. How many of you guys, that sounds good? Right? You guys are like, that sounds I like the first part about being free, I belong to no one. He says, yeah, I got freedom, but I've made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. Do you understand? Like, Paul's primary focus with his life is to win people into the kingdom for Jesus. Even to the point that he's willing to put himself in uncomfortable situations that he doesn't have to, but he will because he wants to bring people to saving grace that is only found in Jesus. He says, to the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law. So he actually kind of put himself in a situation that was a little fake, it sounds. So as to win those under the law, to those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all people so that by all possible means I might save some. Yes. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessing. I become all things to all people so that by all possible means, some might be saved. He will go to any possible mean that he has to share, for somebody to hear the gospel. What I mean by hear it is not just being told it, but finding a way to connect so that they can hear it. He will become things that he doesn't have to become in order that that person might be saved. He will go to the extra mile. He will, any possible mean that he can think of, it's important enough to him that they hear the gospel that he's going to do it. When was the last time any of us can say, and maybe you can, I'm talking to myself, that I can say that I went to any possible mean I could think of to reach another person. I think oftentimes we'll throw our best at it. We'll share the message. If they say no, whatever. Oftentimes we won't change anything about ourselves to reach somebody because we're prideful and we don't think we should change for anybody, right? If they don't accept me for who I am, screw them. I don't need them, right? Completely missing the point. He does it all for the sake of the gospel. The gospel. Ephesians 2, 8 through 9, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It's this free, beautiful gift. This free, beautiful gift. God wants so badly to expand the family. See, the thing is people think that God just wants people to perish, and that's not true. He wants people to come to the knowledge of Christ. Paul understood that. He understood that it's more important to be living a life that aims to please the Father than it is to live a life that pleases Him, Himself. Right? To share the gospel, it's going to take sacrifice. It's going to take getting uncomfortable. It's going to take doing, if you're going to do the stuff that Paul did, you want to be like the Apostle Paul, you want to do, you know, great things, greater works, you want to do all that stuff, well, you're going to start putting yourself on the side burner and put God up front. Mark 16, verse 15 through 16, Jesus said, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. This isn't a, hey, you should go do this, or you might go do this, or hey, think about doing this. This isn't, no, go do this. You know, Timothy, Paul wrote to Timothy and he said, he called him a soldier for Christ. And he said, a soldier's aim isn't to get lost in civilian pursuits and stuff like that, but it's to live a life that pleases the one who enlisted him. And it sounds to me like God wants people to know the gospel. That it's very important to our Father that people come into relationship with Him. So my challenge for us this week is, number one, take a look at your life. If there's stuff in your life that is like number one, number two, that is vapor, is meaningless, is futile, then I would seriously sit down and reconsider where those things should land. So that you're spending your time, or at least the majority of your time, the majority of your focus, your energy, maybe that's a better way to put it, because even if your work, your energy, right, your where your mind's at, the things that you allow into your mind, spending on stuff that matters. And then share the gospel with somebody this week. Listen, I know we're talking about a simple topic of just the gospel, and maybe some of us have gotten bored with that. I hope not. But when we just hang out with Christians, we kind of stop talking about the gospel as much, and we start talking about other things, right? Because we're trying, you know, to have victory in other areas, which is fine, but we shouldn't only be talking to Christians, right? We shouldn't just be in these little silos where we don't, if we don't have any opportunity to share the gospel, we need to think about that for a minute and say, how could I be like Paul and reach somebody? So this week, is it fair to say, let's share the gospel with somebody this week? It could be after church. We have a bunch of people coming. That might be a good place to easy, low-hanging fruit. Share the gospel. No more feeling guilty about your faith. Okay? We're not the bad guys. We're the good guys. Even if the world thinks we're the bad guys, we have no ill will. We just want people to come to know Jesus so that they can be saved. So no being ashamed of the message. It has the power to bring life, restoration, freedom into people's lives. They might not even know what that looks like or what that feels like, but once they get a taste of it, you know they're going to love it, right? No more clamming up out of a fear of rejection, okay? Listen, people, even if they reject the message, they're not really rejecting you. They're rejecting God, right? And so we shouldn't fear rejection, especially when it's with people that we don't even really know. How many of you guys have been afraid that a stranger would reject you? It's like, you don't even know them. Like, you don't even, what are you, like, going to go do life with them? You know, maybe if they come to church or something like that, but we can't let a fear like that stop us from sharing the good news. We're the good guys. The good guys are protectors. They're selfless. They're steady. They want good things for the people around them. Whenever you watch good guys in a movie, you know, they're laying down their life usually, and they're inspiring us by the way that they will selflessly protect and show up for others. And the last thing I just want to say is as we go out there and share the gospel and reignite this excitement to share the good news, it's a simple message. Jesus, right? He died for your sins. He was resurrected. He's ascended to the Father. He's coming back one day. Put faith in Jesus. You'll have eternal life with God. It's not a complex message. But as you share the gospel message, that simple message, and you pray for people, I want to challenge you to ask to pray for people. You might even start the conversation by like, hey, can I pray for you? And as you pray, that could lead into sharing the gospel. But I want you to expect the power of God to start showing up, confirming to that person that the message is true and that it's powerful. And let's just see what the Lord will do. Amen? Amen.